couldn't.
Hi, so I think we can start. So good afternoon, welcome everybody. So I'm not Wolfgang Ketari, I'm Lauriane Chomaz. I am a postdoc in Innsbruck in the group of Francesca Ferlaino. You hear me, yeah? I do experiments on ultra-cold gases of erbium. And it's my great honor and my great pleasure to share this public lecture, which also concludes our very nice Humboldt colleague. And so this public lecture will be held by Wolfgang Ketari, which is professor, who is professor at MIT, and he will talk about cooling to absolute zero temperature, a recipe for discoveries. But before we start, Gediminas asked me to introduce our speaker, and I will try to do this now. So Wolfgang is born in 1957 in Heidelberg, and he grew up in Heidelberg and in the close by town of Eppenheim. He also started his undergraduate study in the University of Heidelberg, but after 2 years he moved to the Technical University of Munich, where he got his diploma in 1982, with a thesis in theoretical physics, in fact. Then for his PhD, he switches to experimental physics and did spectroscopy on small molecule in the group of Professor Herbert Walter and Armut Vicker at the Max Planck Institute for Quantum Optics in Garching, and he obtained his PhD in 1986. Then he stayed as a postdoc in Garching, and then he moved to the University of Heidelberg, where he worked in applied physical chemistry, in fact, on combustion diagnostic. Then in 1990, he decided once again to switch field and to go to more fundamental research, and then that's when he moved to the United States, and he joined the group of Professor Dave Pritchard at MIT. And there he was in fact appointed in MIT in 1993 to the physics faculty of MIT. And he became a professor also there, a John MacArthur professor in 1996. And so during this time, in fact, he developed many of the key techniques to trap and to cool and to probe cold gases that are still used nowadays in the labs. And in 1995, he in fact was one of the first group to realize Bose-Einstein condensation in a cold gas, so a special state of matter where quantum properties are macroscopically visible, and this was in a gas of sodium. And for this achievement in 2001, he received the Nobel Prize together with Eric Cornell and Carl Weinmann. So since 2006, he's also the director of the MIT and Harvard Center for Ultra-Cold Atoms and the associate director of the Research Laboratory of Electronics in MIT. And besides the Nobel Prize, Wolfgang also had numerous prizes. I will not cite them all, but just to give a few. He got the Rabi Prize of the American Physical Society, the Gustav Hertz Prize of the German Physical Society, both in 1997. He got also the Fritz London Prize in low temperature physics in 1999, the Benjamin Franklin Medal in physics in 2000, and as we are here, an Humboldt Research Award in 2009. He's also a member of many physical society and science academy around the world. And before finishing, to say a bit more about his research, since the realization of Bose-Einstein condensation, Wolfgang has been a key actor in the cold atom community, and he has achieved many of seminal results in the field. So without being exhaustive here, if, for example, first, an interesting property in spin of EC, he was the first one to observe a Feshbach resonance, which is a really fundamental ingredient in nowadays experiments still. He observed the first VEC of molecules, and he did also many important work on degenerate Fermi gas, so not with boson, but with fermions, and in particular, proving their superfluidity. And more recently, Wolfgang's come to be more interested into quantum magnetism and synthetic gauge field and spin-orbit coupling. And we can say that one of the last groundbreaking achievement in his group was the observation of supersolidity in spin-orbit coupled BEC last year. So I think I've talked long enough, and then I let the stage to Wolfgang.
Good afternoon. Thank you for the introduction. And I'm really happy that so many of you have come. And I hope it will be interesting and exciting. And what could be more interesting on a hot day like today to hear about the lowest temperatures ever achieved? And I want to teach you some physics, the physics at low temperature, which was actually the subject of the Humboldt colleague, which here at the University of Vilnius brought together researchers from all over the world. But I also want to demonstrate to you some low temperature phenomena, and that's why you see some gadgets here on the stage. So let me start out by saying that going to low temperature has always led to new discoveries. When 100 years ago liquid helium was liquefied for the first time, almost immediately superconductivity was discovered, and the researcher were recognized with a Nobel Prize. So this was the physics at around 1 Kelvin, 1 degree above absolute zero. 1,000 times colder, millikelvin physics, enabled the discovery of superfluidity in helium-3, a very special form of superfluidity from which physicists learned a lot about matter and phase transitions. And again, there was a Nobel Prize for the discoveries made at millikelvin physics. The pioneers who used laser cooling, lasers to cool atoms, reached microkelvin temperatures, and again, they were recognized with a Nobel Prize. And the research I was involved in reached nanokelvin temperatures, 10 to the minus 9 Kelvin, and again, we made some fundamental discoveries. So therefore, going to low temperature is a recipe for discoveries because you can observe things which cannot be observed at higher temperature. And just to explain it very simply, if you live in a hot country, you may never see ice or snow. It's only if you are able to cool to lower temperature that you can see those new forms of matter. So low temperatures dramatically change the properties of materials, and I want to do a few simple demonstrations for you. I want to show you that if I freeze objects to low temperature, they completely change their behavior. So what I have here in this container is liquid nitrogen. I will tell you a little bit more about it. It's a liquid which is really, really cold. So if I take this beautiful flower, it's actually pretty, it's really beautiful. It has all this softness. And if I put it into liquid nitrogen, well, it takes a little bit to cool it down. There's a lot of bubbling, which shows the cooling is in process. And experiments take some patience, you can't rush it. So now it's frozen. And if I just go here, completely different in behavior. Should I do it again? Actually, who is the youngest person in the audience and want to assist me? Any volunteer? It's absolutely safe. You just take it, you put it in liquid nitrogen, you just dip it in. Well, a little bit deeper, like this. It's okay. And then patience, it takes a little while for everything to cool down. probably that should do it. And now you have to decide, you want to keep the flower or do you want to smash it? Okay. Or let me show you something else which can dramatically change the property. What are the properties of a banana? Well, okay, it's pretty soft. But now I want to freeze the banana for you. Banana is a little bit more massive than a rose, so it takes a little bit longer, but... So now I freeze a banana, and you will see that the properties of the banana are very, very different. Not ready yet. So low temperature is completely changing materials. I try to give you a simple introduction with those phenomena, but our conference was about when you go to low temperature, it didn't freeze my hand because it immediately evaporated. Could actually freeze it in dry ice. Whiskey has a freezing point, not very important, but freezing point of minus 20 degrees, and dry ice is minus 78 degrees. So if you put whiskey into dry ice, it will freeze. And what I can show you in about 30 seconds is frozen whiskey. So here is now frozen whiskey, whiskey ice. Now, so whiskey would freeze at 78 degrees in dry ice. Do you know of a liquid which would not even freeze in dry ice? It needs more than minus 80 degrees before it freezes. Well, just go from whiskey, which is 50% alcohol, to pure alcohol. Pure alcohol, it now depends if you have methanol, ethanol, or isopropanol. These are different alcohols. And what I put here into this test tube, and which is now frozen, this is pure alcohol. And pure alcohol, in order to freeze, has to be taken down to minus 100 degrees centigrade. So, let's continue here. Okay, so what did I tell you? Water freezes at 0 degrees. The domestic freezer goes down to minus 20 degrees, and whiskey has a freezing point of minus 26 degrees. So now we are going to lower and lower and lower temperature. We are approaching absolute zero. Dry ice is at minus 78 degrees. So it would not be possible in dry ice to freeze pure alcohol. Pure alcohol needs minus 100 degrees. But then, if we have liquefied air, liquid oxygen and liquid nitrogen, this is about minus 200 degrees. And what I have here in my containers is liquid nitrogen. So therefore, it's easy to freeze pure alcohol. So this shows again sort of the scale. And for those of you who really insist on using Fahrenheit, here's the translation. But you see here the freezing point of dry ice, boiling point of nitrogen, and here is absolute zero. So let's zoom in a little bit on the journey to absolute zero. At 4 Kelvin, helium gas becomes a liquid. It is the gas which stays gaseous for the longest. It's the lowest temperature where you can still have a gas. But at 4 Kelvin, it becomes a liquid. Interstellar space, the interstellar space is a 2.8 Kelvin. This is actually the remnant of the fireball of the Big Bang. Due to cosmic expansion, the universe has cooled down from almost infinite temperature to a temperature which is now 2.8 Kelvin. But then we can go lower, and I mentioned when I addressed the Nobel Prizes, research at millikelvin, at microkelvin, at nanokelvin. So now in the rest of my talk, I want to mainly focus on the very low temperature. 1 nanokelvin, 100 billion times colder than room temperature, 1 billion times colder than interstellar space. So I received the Nobel Prize because I was able to cool atoms down to very low temperature and make a discovery of a special material, the Bose-Einstein condensate, and I will tell you more about it. But before I do that, I want to remind you what happens to atoms or molecules when you cool them down. What happens if we take the air in this room and cool it down to lower temperature? Lower, the velocity goes lower, everything slows down. So I want to demonstrate to you now that atoms and molecules slow down when you lower the temperature. Here at room temperature, the molecules move at the speed of sound at around 300 meters per second. In our research, they move slower than a snail, millimeter per second. So now I want to show you that when I cool down a gas, that the velocity slows down. To really show you moving particles and measure their velocity, I would need sophisticated equipment, but I can remind you of one equation, namely this one, that pressure is density times kinetic energy. This is how we describe gases. So if I have a balloon, the pressure in the balloon is density times kinetic energy. And kinetic energy only depends on the velocity. So therefore, if I use liquid nitrogen again and take this balloon and put it into liquid nitrogen, you will see, when I take it out, that the balloon shrinks. So the shrinking of the balloon, to be a little bit careful with my fingers, the shrinking of the balloon means that the pressure drops, and as you can read from this equation, the fact that the pressure drops means that the velocity and the kinetic energy of the gas has been reduced. And now, of course, if I take it out, it warms up again, it inflates again, so the balloon goes back to the same pressure and the molecules of air have the same velocity and the same kinetic energy again. So this is my, as best as I can do it here on stage, my demonstration that lowering the temperature of molecules and atoms slows down the velocity. Okay, but, and this was important for my research, when we cool down a gas, it's not just that everything slows down. I mean, this would be, you know, pretty cool, pretty interesting, but it wouldn't be really something new, because what happens at reduced temperature is the same physics at very slow motion. However, what happens is when we go to very low temperatures, nanokelvin, something suddenly happens. It's a phase transition as dramatic or even more dramatic than what I demonstrated to you here with the frozen water and the frozen whiskey. Suddenly, the gas of atoms changes its behavior and the gas molecules, which usually move randomly around in all directions, they start marching in lockstep. And this is the Bose-Einstein condensate. This is something which forms only at very low temperature. And marching in lockstep means the gas is superfluid. It behaves as one quantum object. It's like a giant quantum atom. So it has many, many exciting properties, but this only happens at low temperature. And if you wonder how atoms can march in lockstep, I want to replace this picture by that one, that it's actually, those particles are no longer behaving like particles, they behave like one quantum mechanical wave, and marching in lockstep means they are sort of spread out in one quantum mechanical wave and they're completely delocalized. So I can use an analogy to describe to you what this special form of Bose-Einstein condensation is. You're all familiar with light, and I don't think I even have to try, need to explain to you the difference between ordinary light and laser light. Laser light, or let me still do it. Ordinary light means the photons go in all directions. There are many, many modes of the electromagnetic field. In the laser, all the photons march in lockstep. It's just one wave. And exactly the differences I just made between ordinary light and laser light describes the difference between an ordinary gas and the Bose-Einstein condensate. Here everything moves in all directions, and here the atoms move in lockstep, form one big wave, exactly as the light in the laser. So if I try to describe the discovery for which I received the Nobel Prize to you in a single sentence, I would say, I created for atoms what the laser is for light, a very special form of performance. I will not describe to you how we get to nano-Kelvin atoms. This would be a lecture on its own, and it's an interesting story how combinations of lasers, evaporation, eventually lead to cold atoms, and then we can do all sorts of experiments with cold atoms. I rather want to give you an impression how the research is done. So this shows one of our cold atom machines at MIT. You see a vacuum chamber here, you see some laser light and lots of cables and water lines. So this is sort of the complexity of the experiment. And most importantly, young students. This research is really done by undergraduate and graduate students and some postdocs, but young people who have a fresh mind for research. Here you see sort of a close-up. This is a vacuum chamber. This is about 7-8 centimeters. You see optics and lenses. And the cold Bose-Einstein condensate, it forms right behind this window. And we can look at it with digital cameras. And we use laser light. We cannot touch the Bose-Einstein condensate. We have to cool it with light. We have to look at it with light. So we need lots of laser lights. And I like this picture because this is a situation where we have three different colors of laser light. Yellow for sodium, red for lithium, and green for special purposes. And what you see here is, just looking through the vacuum viewport, you see a cloud of yellow sodium atoms. What we have here is sodium vapor, which you find also in the yellow street lamps. We have laser light from all directions, and then the magic of laser cooling happens, which means we have a cloud, this little cloud of atoms is 1,000 times colder than interstellar space. It's very cold, much colder than anything I can show you today, but then we have to cool it even further down to Bose-Einstein condensation. So what you should imagine is that at the end of our preparation or cycle, of our cooling cycle, we have a vacuum chamber, ultra-high vacuum. This is the world's best thermos. It completely isolates the cold atoms from the high temperature of our laboratory. And the atoms, to make sure they stay in the middle of this vacuum chamber, are in another container, but it's not a material container. We could not cool any material container to such low temperatures. We can only cool the atoms, and the atoms are surrounded literally by a box made out of electric or magnetic fields. So you can say the atoms are a little bit magnetic, and they are surrounded by magnetic fields, and whenever they want to go left, right, up, down, forward, backward, there are magnetic forces or electric forces which push them back. So this is how you can think about it. And then we have to observe it. How do we find out how cold these atoms are? Well, we can switch off the box, and then the atoms expand. And then by illuminating the atoms with laser light, they cast a shadow, and then we observe the shadow with a digital camera. But I mean, physics is really simple, because we allowed the cloud to expand. So then, therefore, this cloud immediately tells us what its temperature is, because the cloud started very small. In the time we allowed it to expand, it expanded to this size. And it expanded with a velocity which is the thermal velocity. And the most complicated equation in my talk is, if you square the velocity, you get the kinetic energy, and kinetic energy is nothing else than an absolute measure for temperature. So by observing how the cloud expands, and taking a digital picture, we can pretty much take the ruler, measure the size of this cloud, insert it into this formula, and this is the temperature. But now we want to go a little bit lower down to temperature. I want to now show you how the Bose-Einstein condensate forms, how this phase transition happens, where atoms are starting to march in lockstep. So let me just explain what we do. We take the atoms, we cool them down, and then we allow them to expand, and we take a picture. So those atoms have done their job, and our pumps take care of them. But then, 10 or 20 seconds later, we cool another batch of atoms down to low temperature, but this time, we turn the dial on our refrigerator to a little bit lower temperature. So the cloud is now a little bit colder. How will the shadow of the colder cloud look like? Colder means lower velocity, and that means when the cloud has expanded, it is smaller. So we will directly observe in a series of pictures now that step by step, by going to lower temperature, the cloud gets smaller and smaller. But then you will see something else. So the cloud is now, we are at maybe a few hundred nanokelvin, the cloud is shrinking. It shrinks, it gets colder. But about now, you see something happens. It looks like the cherry which has a pit inside. We call it a bimodal distribution. There is sort of a fuzzy part, and then there is, I play it again for you, this inner part which is smaller. But smaller means it doesn't expand at all. It's so cold that during the observation time it hardly expands. So that means here how small this shadow is. Those atoms are literally at absolute zero temperature. But there's something else which was striking, and this is this shadow which remained, these very, very cold atoms, and actually the elliptical part are these atoms which march in lockstep, was elliptical. But initially, the cloud was spherical. There was a change in symmetry, a change in shape. And if some properties suddenly change, this is like a phase transition. It is actually a phase transition from liquid to solid. So what was going on here is the following. I didn't tell you that our magnetic box is elongated. But it's just much easier if you deal with magnetic fields to build an elongated magnetic box. But for an ordinary gas, it just moves randomly in all directions. Or scientifically speaking, the velocity distribution is isotropic. So therefore, the gas expands in all directions. But when you have a Bose-Einstein condensate, you have atoms march in lockstep. They are just one wave. And to say it simply, if you have an elliptical wave initially, you also see the ellipse when the wave expands. So therefore, you have seen the transition from a randomly moving gas to something which has different properties, wave-like properties. Okay, but maybe you would say, well, that's pretty nice. This was actually the story of the discovery, and what we saw is, yeah, the condensate is very, very cold, and it has changed its property. But now I want to show you how we can even very directly show that these atoms march in lockstep. How do you show that atoms march in lockstep? Well, I have to translate. This means they are coherent, they behave like a wave. So therefore, what we had to show in order to prove this special property of this new form of matter was that these atoms behave like one big wave. So how do you do that? Well, let me first contrast with something which doesn't show wave properties, and this is red paint. If you have a paintball and throw it on a wall, I don't want to demonstrate it here, but you get a you know, red patch of paint, and if you take two such paint balls and they and the spots overlap, what you see here is something very simple. Red paint and red paint gives darker red paint. But now do the same experiment with a red laser beam. One red laser beam gives a red spot on the wall. But if you have two red laser beams, you see something else. You see the phenomenon of wave interference. You see regions of brightness and darkness. Because light is a wave, light is an electric field. And what you see is, where you have darkness, that positive electric field and negative electric fields can add up to zero, and that means there is darkness. So therefore, you get the idea, two paintballs, two laser beams, we need two Bose-Einstein condensates. So we now did an experiment with two Bose-Einstein condensates. We knew how to make one Bose-Einstein condensate, and then we took a laser beam, little like a laser knife, and we were cutting the Bose-Einstein condensate into two parts. So now we have two Bose-Einstein condensates. We switch off all the electric and magnetic fields and they fall down, but due to some internal pressure, they also expand into each other. And now the question is, and then we take a picture with our digital camera, again a shadow picture. So the question is, will these atoms behave like paint, like ordinary matter, or will they behave like light? And what we observed was this pattern, which looks like a zebra, a wonderful interference pattern of straight lines. There is a little bit of noise because we couldn't use a lot of light for because we didn't want to destroy the condensate. But so what you see here is, you see dark areas and there is a shadow. That means there are atoms. But in between, where the light comes through, between the black stripes, if the light comes through, there is no shadow, there are no atoms. So what you see here is, you see actually the equation that atoms and atoms have interfered, have added up to nothing. Exactly as light and light can add up to darkness. But this was the final proof that atoms, that this new form of matter consists of atoms which march in lockstep. So, now I would like to demonstrate to you that particles can march in lockstep. I don't have the equipment here to show it to you with atoms, but I want to use the phenomenon of superconductivity, because superconductivity is kind of a Bose-Einstein condensate, but it's a Bose-Einstein condensate of electron pairs. So therefore, I can actually here demonstrate to you in a few minutes that electrons march in lockstep. Now, I don't have the equipment to show you exactly how the electrons march in lockstep, but when electrons march in lockstep in a circle, that forms a current. And the current forms a magnetic field. And this is what I can demonstrate to you. But before I can point out the special property of a superconductor, I have to remind you of some simple physics, and this is the physics of eddy currents. If you have a piece of copper and you have a magnet and you drop the magnet, then by Faraday's law of induction, the magnetic field induces a current in the copper called an eddy current, and this eddy current will slow down the fall of the magnet. So let me now demonstrate to you the eddy current. So what I have here is a tube of copper, and I have a metal object. And I want to drop this metal object, and, well, I let it go. It just falls down. Can do it again. Yep. Okay. But this object, it looks silvery, but it's not a magnet. But now I have an object which has the same weight, the same size, but this is now a magnet, and I want to drop this magnet, and you will see that there is a big difference how long it takes for that to come out. So this is eddy currents. The falling magnet, the changing magnetic field, creates currents in the copper, and this current creates a magnetic field, and the magnetic field slows down the motion of the magnet. So this has nothing to do with superconductor, but it shows a principle, namely how a changing magnetic field can create a current. But copper is an ordinary conductor. Copper has a resistance, and after a very short time, the current in the copper will die down, and this is why eventually the magnet arrived at the end of the tube. So this is what I just showed you. So, but now, if we replace the copper by a superconductor, then we will create a current of these superconducting electrons, which is a supercurrent, which will not decay. And therefore, this magnet, when I lower it on a superconductor, should just levitate, because the current which are induced, not in the copper, but now in the superconductor, are permanent. So experiments with superconductors are a little bit tricky, so we need a little bit of patience. But let's get ready. I need liquid nitrogen. I'm sure you want to see something. So let's get ready. So what I have here is little styrofoam cup. I take one of my superconductors, put them in. The superconductor is a black disc. It's at room temperature, but now I pour liquid nitrogen in it. And now we are cooling down this ceramic disc. It's a high temperature superconductor. We are cooling it down to the temperature of liquid nitrogen, which is minus 198 degrees. And then the liquid nitrogen, then the superconductor becomes, then the material becomes superconducting. So what I have here now is, this silvery square part is a strong magnet. And so now I'm repeating for you the experiment I did with the copper tube, but now I have a superconductor. So if I take this magnet and move it on top of the superconducting disk, it now creates an eddy current. And if it works, this eddy current should lead to, should levitate the magnet. Almost. I tried it before the lecture and it did work. So what I demonstrated to you is now that a superconductor is different from copper. You create a current and the current does not decay. And the fact that the current does not decay means it's not an ordinary current, it's a supercurrent consisting of electrons which march in lockstep. Okay, that was number one. Okay, so I try to be a good teacher, so I have summaries for you. I have a piece of copper oxide, it's cooled down. There is a phase transition. At the phase transition, the electrons march in lockstep. They form this macroscopic quantum state. Everything behaves like one wave. The superconducting current has no dissipation, is therefore persistence. And this persistent current creates a magnetic field, and the magnet floats. Very simple. Well, so this can actually be explained as I did with the copper tube by Faraday's law of induction. I create an eddy current, but the eddy current is now dissipationless. But there is more. I want to now take it to the next level. I will immediately, in a minute, do the demonstration for you that I take a superconducting disk at high temperature, it's not superconducting yet, and I put a magnet on top of it. So I'm not moving a magnet up and down, I just place the two things together and then I cool it down. So since no magnet is moving, there are no eddy currents. And you would think, well, no eddy currents, nothing should happen. But what I want to demonstrate to you, if I take this superconducting disk with a magnet on top of it and it reaches the superconducting temperature, the magnet will suddenly lift off. This is called the Meissner effect, but I first want to show you the demonstration and then I want to explain it to you. So, what do we need? Another superconducting disk, which is here. Oh, you want to see it on camera, of course. Okay, so in this blue styrofoam cup, I've just put a superconducting disk, but I'm not cooling it yet. And now I take this small neodymium magnet. And I just put the neodymium magnet on top of the superconductor. So I hope you see the silver part, the strong magnet on top of the superconductor. And all we do it now, we cool it down, we chill it down. So there is no motion, there is no eddy current. And all low temperature experiments take a little while. So we should just wait until the liquid nitrogen is cooling the superconductor to minus 200 degrees. And then there will be a phase transition. The ceramic disk will become superconducting. And eventually something should happen. And I think you see that the magnet has lifted off. The magnet, maybe I can turn it around for you. You see that it's a little bit at an angle, but it's clearly floating above the surface. And if we would wait a while, if the magnet, the superconductor would warm up again, the effect would disappear. Okay, let me explain what you have seen. So what I showed to you was that superconductivity is much more than just dissipationless current and eddy currents, persistent currents. It's actually a phase transition where the supermagnetic, superconducting material becomes extremely diamagnetic. Diamagnetic materials expel all magnetic fields, and you can expel a magnetic field by creating an opposite magnetic field, and this is called the Meissner effect. So what I demonstrated for you was that initially the magnetic field was just penetrating the superconductor. But the moment the phase transition was happening, the superconductor, shown in blue, was creating an anti-magnetic field, expelling the magnetic field out of its volume, and this anti-magnetic field made the small magnet to lift off. And this is the Meissner effect. And this is much more subtle and much more fundamental than the first demonstration with the persistent eddy currents. Okay, but now I want to show you a third effect, which is the effect of flux pinning. So far what I've explained to you, and the physicists probably immediately get it, that there is a Meissner effect, which is a repulsive force. The magnet is repelled. But now I want to show you that in real superconducting materials, there is another spectacular effect, which is called flux pinning. In type 2 superconductors at high magnetic field, the magnetic field is not expelled. It is sort of concentrated on certain spots, and this is called flux pinning. The flux lines, the magnetic field is pinned. And this now pinned in a direction that this is creating almost like a rigid connection between the magnetic field and the superconducting disk. And this is what I want to demonstrate. To show you that in addition to the Meissner effect that creates the repulsive force, there is I use now a different superconducting disk, which will show more prominently the flux pinning, and I will explain to you in a few minutes what the difference between those disks are. So let me take this disk. Put it in here. Let's cool it down. Yes, we have to change. Okay. Okay, that was just about the right time to cool down this superconductor. So I think you can see there is a black disk, and I want to use now a small magnet, but immediately demonstrate to you that the properties of this superconductor are different from the superconductor I've shown you before. So I think if I put it down, it should first float. Oopsie. So I think you see it floating. So it looks like the Meissner effect I've demonstrated to you first. But now I want to just take this disk, push down on it, and it just gets stuck to the magnet. If there were a Meissner effect, you would think it's like a springy action and it should go back, but it doesn't, because what happens is the superconductor has flux lines, they are pinned, and when I move it, I actually, by some force, move the flux lines to a new position, and then they're getting pinned again. And let me finally come to my last demonstration, which is actually my most fancy superconductor. It is a disk which has an enormous flux pinning force. And I want to show you that what happens. So let me, I put in the superconductor, I have a thin spacer of non-magnetic material, and now I need a strong magnet, and I put the strong magnet on top of it. So what I've made is a sandwich. ITC superconductor, a thin insulating layer, just a spacer, and then a very strong magnet. And as you can see already from the size, it's a big magnet, it's a really strong one. So all we have to do is now add a little bit of liquid nitrogen. This is a bigger superconductor, so it takes a little bit longer to cool. Good. It's not yet superconducting. If you wonder how I see it, I try to move the spacer and I realize there is not yet magnetic force between the magnet and the superconductor. So it takes another 30 seconds or so. Okay, it's getting there. Yeah. So now I want to take the spacer out. So I've taken the spacer out and the superconductor is now floating, but it is floating, you know, in a fixed position. The flux is pinned. I can even rotate it, put it to the side. I really feel the force now of the superconductor. I can pick it up. So this is no longer, for the physicist, the repulsive force of the Meissner effect. What you see here is, it's an attractive force. The magnet is, the two parts are literally glued together. Okay, I want to do one last demonstration, which is the demonstration of a magnetic bearing. For that, I have to first make sure that the superconductor is no longer superconducting. It has already warmed up, that's good. And now I put things back and cool it down. And then I want to show you what is called a magnetic bearing. This also shows you now a possible application of superconducting magnetic forces. If you can levitate objects, you can actually levitate objects without any friction. And some superconducting levitation is, at least for a while, it was a candidate for levitating trains, that instead of having trains on rails, you wanted to have trains which were magnetically levitated. So now I wasn't fast enough. The superconductor became superconducting, and once it's superconducting, I can't really put the magnet on top of it. So let's now just I feel a magnetic force, which means the ceramic disc is still superconducting. It has still some, or it has some flux pinned. And what I need is, I need it to return to the normal state, and then I can put the magnet on top of it, which is now perfect. So now, that's my last experiment. I cool it down. And what I then want to do is, I have this heavy object made of aluminum, and now I want to put this heavy object on the magnet, and the force of the superconducting magnet, the flux pinning, is strong enough to levitate this heavy object. So once it is superconducting, I will take the spacer out, which I do now. Okay, so I took the spacer out. We have the superconducting levitation, and now I just put this heavy object on top of it. It is now supported by the magnetic flux pinning of the superconductor, and I can just rotate it, and it is a frictionless magnetic bearing because there is an air gap between the magnet and the superconductor. Okay, now I can relax because we've done all the demonstrations. So let me fill in a little bit of information. The superconductor I've shown to you was an yttrium barium copper oxide superconductor. It has a transition temperature at minus 183 degrees, and fortunately liquid nitrogen is 15 degrees colder. What I had shown you first was a polycrystalline form which has a low critical current and therefore the Meissner effect was dominating. These were my first two demonstrations. And the last two demonstrations were done with actually the same material, but it was more a single domain, a single crystal form. Therefore, it had a high critical current, and what I could demonstrate to you was the effect of flux penetration and flux pinning. Okay, so what we have seen with my superconducting demonstration is persistent currents, flux pinning, that flux pinning provides lateral stability, and I've shown the magnetic suspension effect with attractive and repulsive forces, and I've shown the magnetic bearing. So let me now come back, if I have 5 or 10 more minutes, let me now come back to my own research. Just remember, I told you about a journey to low temperature. I demonstrated to you lower and lower temperatures. I showed you that particles slow down at lower temperature, but at least with the electrons, I could show you that they also march in lockstep. So let me now move further and say what we created at this low temperature with these atoms marching in lockstep was actually a new material. And for the past 20 years, and this was also the subject here at the conference, we have studied more and more new materials. Because the discovery of Bose-Einstein condensation was not just the discovery of a new material, it was also we developed the methods and the technology to cool close to absolute zero. And now, when we cool atoms close to absolute zero, they literally stand still and they become Lego pieces, and we can now take those Lego pieces and arrange them into new and interesting materials. And this is what has still, there are still a lot of open questions, that we are not running out of ideas, what special materials we can build out of our atomic Legos. So let me now finally connect with current research. How are we assembling our Lego pieces? You're already familiar with this setup, a vacuum chamber and many, many atoms in a box made with electric and magnetic fields. But now we can modify the properties of those cold atoms by sending in multiple laser beams, radio waves and microwaves. And with those, we change the properties of the material. And I just want to give you one example, and this is the example of a crystal. Who is not impressed by looking at a crystal and seeing the beauty of nature? Symmetry, crystalline, periodic arrangement of atoms creates beauty. Actually, I have to say, this crystal is beautiful because it's not completely regular. It has many, many different facets. So in fundamental research, we study usually phenomena in their simplest form, and that would mean most of our experiments on atoms in a periodic crystal are made using a cubic lattice, which is the crystal configuration of table salt. So what I want to explain you, and this is the last topic of my lecture, is how do we arrange atoms to look like a crystal of table salt? Well, we can only talk to the atoms, we cannot touch them, we can only talk to them with laser beams. And if we take not just one laser beam, but two laser beams, remember the red light on the wall, they interfere, they form regions of darkness and brightness. And the atoms are attracted by electric fields. So therefore, if we create such a standing wave of light, the atoms will line up like the beads on a string. They will form a periodic array. And if we use two pairs of laser beams, the electric field creates the same potential as this egg carton does for eggs. And then if we put atoms into such a potential, they will go to the place of lowest potential energy, that's where they are attracted to by the electric field, and arrange themselves by eggs. And this can also happen in three dimensions. So what people have observed here with a microscope is how the atoms arrange themselves. And if you look at this picture, This is a sparsely filled lattice. You see each green spot is a single atom. We can see single atoms with a microscope, and they arrange themselves on a square lattice. So they're really in a periodic array. Now, you would say, why don't you just use eggs? Eggs are probably cheaper than your equipment, but there's a difference. Eggs, well, you know the properties of eggs, but atoms are quantum mechanical waves. They can actually tunnel. They can go through the wall from one side to the next side. And this is what I want to demonstrate to you. So here, researchers at Harvard had lined up atoms, and now they can spread out, they can tunnel, and if they randomly hop around, they will spread out. And you would say, well, if you shake your eggs carefully, maybe you can create that. But now look what happens as a function of time. These atoms spread out, but then magically, they come back. And this is another manifestation that those atoms are waves. When you see those dots, you shouldn't think you just see eggs hopping around. What really happens is, it is an atomic wave which spreads out, and when we flash on the light and detect the atoms, we see a green spot somewhere within this wave packet. But what you then see is, when time evolves, all those waves which spread out synchronize, and at the end, they are all interfering in one position, which is the original position. So here you see that atoms move through walls, tunnel from side to side, but behave as waves and come back to the same position. Also, what is different between eggs and atoms are, I mean, try to put two eggs in one position on your egg carton and you create a problem. But with atoms, you can do that, assuming the atoms are not repelling each other. There is no repulsive force between the atoms. But if you increase the repulsive force, then the atoms behave like eggs. So what looks like a very simple system to you is actually a quantum phase transition between a superfluid where the atoms can move around, and sometimes you find two or three atoms on one side, where the atoms are eventually localized, and this is an isolator. There is no transport possible anymore. And this phase transition, another phase transition, from a superfluid to an insulator, is just what we try to understand mathematically. We want to deeply understand what is exactly the physics which is going on here, because this is paradigmatic for phase transition. And I would estimate that about 1,000 papers have been written in the last years about this phase transition. So this is where we stand in our research. And finally, let me just tease you with some of the latest research we have done. We have discovered at low temperature a new form of matter, and it is actually a gas, a liquid, and a solid at the same time. You may wonder, well, modern science goes beyond the usual classification of materials. So we've observed something which is superfluid, but it is also solid at the first same time. And I'm not even trying to describe it to you. I just want to show you a cartoon that in a solid, we usually have each atom in a regular crystal, each atom is localized, whereas in a superfluid, remember the blue guys which were smeared out, particles form one wave. And it seemed first impossible to have both at the same time, but if you do something like this, and this is what we did, we created a super solid. So anyway, this just shows you with the last few examples where the current research is about. So let me summarize by saying what I demonstrated to you is a journey to absolute zero temperature, but it's also a quest for new materials, following our desire to understand nature and materials at a deeper and deeper level. And to some extent, what we do in the laboratory, we are trying out, if it's possible, by playing our atomic Lego games, to create materials like a super solid, which have never existed before. And the moment we create it, we know that those materials exist in nature. However, it's a long step and it may take several decades before the insight into new materials, which we obtain at extremely low temperature, leads to practical new materials. But this is the typical time constant from new ideas and new insight in fundamental research towards practical applications. So my last comment is, I try to give you a taste what happens at low temperature, new quantum materials happen, but I want to also mention that our research is connected to some of the bigger quantum initiatives which now happen in the United States, in the UK, in the European Union, because the quantumness of those materials, and I demonstrated some of them to you, is now leading to new devices, to new technology, to new quantum sensors. So this kind of quantum physics, which becomes very prominent at low temperature, is also at the verge of creating new technological applications. So with that, I thank you for your attention.
So thank you very much for this very inspiring and this very entertaining lecture. So I'm sure there are many questions from the audience. So if you have questions, just raise the hand and I will pass the microphone. Oh.
Do you imagine what would be the properties of these super solids in comparison to normal solids?
Well, a super solid would share properties with solid materials, which would mean it has a shape, it has some form, but at the same time that it is possible to have frictionless transport, to have supercurrents or superfluidity. So it would combine the properties of a solid with the properties of a superfluid. Now, before we get too excited about it, I should maybe tell you what we've done is, we had actually, we work at very low temperature and very low density. So it's not a solid where you can knock on it and feel the solid. What we created, and this was qualifying as a super solid, was actually a Bose-Einstein condensate, which is a gas, but it spontaneously had a density modulation, which is a shape, a form, usually only associated with a solid phase. So what we created was, in many regards, it's still a gas, but it has a spontaneous texture in it, and this is the defining feature of a solid. So maybe I'm now taking you on a little bit excursion, what is for a scientist the defining property of a solid? And it is a spontaneous shape, a spontaneous texture or structure. If you ask me what would be an application, I'm actually honest, I say maybe none. So sometimes in curiosity-driven research, we try to do something which is special, which is paradoxical, because when we do that, we get new ideas and new insight. And the super solid was something which was a challenge to do. We had some ideas how we could test some theoretical predictions and perform this experiment. So, but this is how we actually proceed in fundamental research. Sometimes we have an application in mind and try to work towards it. But sometimes we just have an idea which looks maybe a little bit crazy but interesting, and then we try it out. And often then, after realizing something, then there are other ideas how maybe this can be turned into something practical. So science works in both ways.
Yeah, there were a question there.
Thank you for a very entertaining lecture indeed, and I would like to ask you a bit more funny questions, but those are not offensive, not at all. First of all, you said there was a sentence about lasers, right? You showed a picture of red laser is for lithium and the yellow is for something else, and you said the green is for special purposes. So what are those special purposes?
What is the special purpose of the green laser? The one thing we did actually with the green laser is we were cutting, this was our laser knife to cut the Bose-Einstein condensate into two parts. Because in a public lecture I simplify, I said atoms are attracted by the electric field of a laser, but this is only valid when the laser is at lower frequency. If the laser is green or blue, the opposite happens. And so with the green laser, it repels the atoms and we can literally use it as a knife to cut one cloud into two pieces. So this is what we did with the green light.
Oh, okay, thank
we can,
you.
We can drill holes into clouds, we can create little donut clouds and little rings. So this is what we do with green light. And with the red light, we do just the opposite. We make little clumps of atoms.
Thank you for the explanation. And the second question is, so have you tried freezing other alcohol than whiskey? What were the results?
Sorry, to freeze what?
Other alcoholic drinks than whiskey. Did you notice any differences or anything?
Not really. And actually, I have to say, I have some good whiskey at home, but I rather drink it than freeze it. What I was freezing here was the cheapest whiskey I could get my hands on.
Okay, there is a question.
Hi, thanks for the lecture. I wanted to ask, is it possible to create a superconductor that works at room temperature? And if yes, what would be needed for such kind of a material?
Is it possible? So the question is it possible to create a superconductor at room temperature? Unfortunately not. The superconductors I demonstrated to you here are called high temperature superconductors because they can become superconducting already at the high temperature of minus 180 degrees. Because in the past, superconductors became superconducting only at much lower temperature. You needed liquid helium, and you would not have been able to demonstrate it in a lecture. So, but this is one question. If you had room temperature superconductors, you would save 10 or 20% of the electrical power all over the world because you can transmit power through superconductors which have persistent dissipationless currents and you would have no transmission losses. And just imagine if all our iPhones and computers were superconducting, what new possibilities would arise from that? So I could say to all the people in the audience, especially the young ones, if you go to the laboratory and discover a room temperature superconductor, you will trigger a big, big technological revolution. But will those high temperature superconductors ever been found? The answer is we don't know. There is intense research on superconductors and a deeper and deeper understanding. Nobody has found a theorem which says it's impossible. So it still seems possible and people are looking for it. So this is an open question of research if room temperature superconductors will ever be realized.
There is another question here.
Thank you for a very nice lecture and also for demonstrations. And I would like to ask what kind of atoms or isotopes you choose for your experiments, especially when you have to look on the summary spin.
The atoms we have used in our research are alkali atoms in the first column of the periodic table, sodium, rubidium, and lithium. People have now, including the chairwoman of the session, have studied other atoms like erbium, but the alkali atoms are the simplest atoms because we can excite them with visible lasers, so it's easy to handle them, so the technology is simpler for those atoms. But in principle, we can pick almost any atom in the periodic table. It's just sometimes a bigger experimental effort to cool those atoms.
Is there a question in the back?
All right, so I'd like to ask why doesn't the light used to illuminate the condensate destroy it?
The question is, why doesn't the light destroy the Bose-Einstein condensate?
Yes.
Well, it depends. Sometimes we use very, very weak light and it doesn't destroy it. But for the results I've shown to you, we used actually strong light and it destroyed the condensate. But what you observed is you have the shape of the condensate. You flash on some strong light, and if the flash of light is very short and you take the picture quickly, you've sort of frozen in the state of the Bose-Einstein condensate and taken an image.
Thank you.
It's the same thing, you know, if I had a powerful X-ray flash and I want to take a picture of you. I say smile, I flash my X-rays, I get a nice picture where you are smiling, but the moment you smiled, you were dead because the X-rays killed you. So if you take the picture fast enough, you don't have to wonder about the consequences of the light or the X-rays.
Okay, there is one question in the back.
Thank you for a great lecture, and I would also want to ask you one question. We didn't discuss a lot about liquid helium. There's one question that's been haunting me for over a decade, and the question is, when we put liquid helium in the bottle, it wants to leave the bottle like after some time. Why would it do that? Is it because of zero viscosity, or are there other physical occurrences that are responsible for it?
So this person is asking about a special property of liquid helium, and this is the following property. It's really creepy. I've put liquid nitrogen in this box, but if you have liquid helium, it will actually creep out, it will creep along the walls and get out of the container. And this is sort of the film creep or the film flow of superfluid helium, and the property is related to the vanishing viscosity. Because there is adhesion, the liquid is attracted by the surface and wants to cover the surface, but for normal liquid, there is no transport because there is viscosity in the thin film and you go nowhere. But in the absence of viscosity, you can completely cover the surface and you will literally have liquid helium creeping over the walls of the container.
Other questions?
What happens if you try to achieve fully destructive interference of Bose-Einstein condensate or the supersolid? Do the particles just disappear, or what happens?
If I understand it correctly, the question is about what happens when two Bose-Einstein condensates interfere. And of course, when I was saying you have regions of where you don't find atoms, and atoms have added up to nothing. That's the same as if you interfere two laser beams and light adds up to darkness. But what happens is the missing energy in an optical interference pattern is in the bright fringes. So therefore, when you interfere light, you find no light in certain places, but then you find twice the intensity you would naively expect in the bright fringes. So energy has not disappeared when you interfere light. Energy has just been shifted from the dark regions to the bright region. And exactly the same happens when we interfere to Bose-Einstein condensates. Atoms are missing in certain places, but they appear in the neighboring places as enhanced density.
So this doesn't work like with sound waves, so you can cancel them completely?
Okay, if you have two beams at an angle, they form fringes like a zebra, and then in these interference fringes, you shift energy or atoms, whatever you interfere, from the dark area to the bright area.
All right.
Now what happens is, if you have Well, if you have a sound wave and you want to cancel it, you sort of have to work close to the source. If I create a sound wave here and I create an anti-sound wave here, it is as if the energy is never radiated away. So it really goes from one source to the other source. But with light and atoms, which are in free flight, you cannot make them disappear because it would violate a conservation law. So if you have two laser pulses, they have to interfere and you get the dark and bright fringes. You can never cancel the light because it would violate the conservation of energy. And the same applies, we have two atoms cloud in free fall. Mass is conserved, the atoms cannot disappear. They could only be shifted in their position from the dark to the bright area.
I have another question here.
Yeah, I was just wondering, you have like a super solid and a super liquid. Is there also something like a super gas?
Yes, actually, the Bose-Einstein condensate was the first gaseous superfluid. You know what happens is we actually in physics often use the word fluid for gases and liquids together, because the difference between liquids and gases in science is very small. I mean, a liquid also has no shape, it flows around and all that. A liquid is just denser than a gas. But if you actually pressurize a gas, you come to the critical point and you can go continuously from the gas to the liquid, the jump in density has disappeared. So in that sense, liquid and gas is more something we use in everyday's world, but in physics and science, we classify them both as fluids. But yeah, if you want, that's correct. Liquid helium was the first superfluid, the same real liquid in everyday sense, which turned superfluid, and the Bose-Einstein condensate was the first gas, which shared the property of superfluidity.
Okay, other questions?
This time I will give you a serious question, not a funny one anymore. Well, on an interview I read that you said that there are experiments going to be performed in cosmos and space, I wanted to ask, are there any effects expected to happen in the microgravity conditions?
Okay, the question is referring to the fact that a Bose-Einstein condensation experiment is now flying on the space station. NASA has launched a module to the space station that now in microgravity on the space station, experiments can be performed with ultra-cold atoms. The motivation for those experiments is that whenever we do experiments on Earth, we have to think about gravity. The atoms will always fall down, and if we lower the temperature of atoms to very, very low temperature, there is hardly any kinetic energy in the gas, but gravitational energy is there. So therefore, gravity in certain ways limits or at least affects the experiment we do in the laboratory. And what NASA has now created, a microgravity laboratory where you can study Bose-Einstein condensates and other forms of matter in the absence of gravity. So the hope is that this will lead to further insight into new materials, but also into higher precision measurements with ultra-cold atoms, such as atomic clocks and atom interferometry.
There is another question here.
Thank you very much for interesting talk. Liquids always have a surface and a property associated with surface as surface tension or surface energy. What is known about the surface energy of Bose-Einstein condensates?
What is the surface and the surface tension of a Bose-Einstein condensate? Well, I showed you shadow pictures of the Bose-Einstein condensate, and there is sort of a surface, but in contrast to normal surfaces, the surface is sort of spread out, because the Bose-Einstein condensate has sort of a smooth transition. This is also related to the fact that our container consists of magnetic fields, which are not sharp walls, they are sort of soft walls. It's a little bit like if you put milk in a cereal bowl. It's not that the milk is there and then it stops. It's sort of, you know, the height of the milk gets less and less and less as you go up the as you go further outside in your bowl. So it's similar what atoms do in an atom trap. So therefore the concept of surface tension is a little bit different, but I can reassure you there is a term in the equations describing the Bose-Einstein condensate which consists of surface tension. But this surface tension is pure kinetic energy, but I don't want to try to convince you of that.
Okay, some further questions? If not, then I think it's time to conclude this lecture.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.